Welcome to online church today. We're so glad that you can join us for church as we gather together, St. Martin's and St. Peter's gathering as one. We're thankful to our great God for his kindness and mercy to us. We want to bring before God our prayers for those who are still suffering through the coronavirus. We particularly pray that the outbreaks in Melbourne and Victoria would come under control. We pray for those places in the world where the virus is still growing and people are still losing their lives. We want to pray for God to have mercy on our world, that we and all around us might see the great hope that we have in the Lord Jesus Christ. I want to thank you for joining us online today, whether you're local, whether you're a member of one of our congregations, or whether you're joining us from around the world. It's great to welcome you here. We exist to make and mature disciples of Jesus, and we want to help you to connect to God and to us. We want to see you grow up in faith. We want to see you serving and using the gifts that God has given you for his glory, that we might tell all the world of the good news of Jesus. This is what we do together. We've begun our Wednesday service at St. Martin's, 10 o'clock, and it's been a joy to be able to meet together and share in the Lord's Supper. And we've had some from the St. Martin's Sunday 8 a.m. service joining there. It's been a terrific time of fellowship and growing in faith in the Lord. Next Sunday, we begin our 9 a.m. service at St. Peter's East Linfield, our 10 a.m. service at St. Martin's Kalara, and our 6 p.m. young adult service at St. Peter's East Linfield. Now, I'm looking forward to those beginning and seeing how it is that we might praise and honour God together, that we might hear his word and say our prayers, encouraging one another to go out in faith, hope and love. Psalmist writes in Psalm 47, "Clap your hands, all you nations. Shout to God with cries of joy. How awesome is the Lord Most High, the great King over all the earth. He subdued the nations under us, peoples under our feet. He chose our inheritance for us, the pride of Jacob whom he loved. God ascended amid shouts of joy, the Lord amid the sounding of trumpets. Sing praises to God, sing praises to our King. Sing praises, for God is the King of all the earth. Sing to him a psalm of praise. God reigns over the nations. God is seated on his holy throne. The nobles of the nations assemble as the people of the God of Abraham. For the kings of the earth belong to God. He is greatly exalted." Well, we'll sing praises to God in just a moment, but let me pray. Gracious God, you have prepared for those who love you such good things as pass our understanding. Pour into our hearts such love toward you, that loving you above all things, we may obtain your promises, which exceed all that we can desire, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us sing God's praise.
Minions live your glory by proud of the
Let us pray. Almighty God, under whom all hearts be open, all desires known and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love thee and worthily magnify thy holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Jesus said, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and all your strength. This is the great and first commandment. And the second is like it. Love your neighbour as yourself. All the law and the prophets hang on these two commandments. Lord, have mercy upon us, and write all these thy laws in our hearts, we beseech thee." Our collect for the fourth Sunday after Easter. O Almighty God, who alone canst order the unruly wills and affections of sinful people, grant unto thy people that they may love the thing which thou commandest and desire that which thou dost promise, that so among the sundry and manifold changes of the world, our hearts may surely there be fixed, where true joys are to be found, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Today's Bible reading comes from 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 7 to 18. Let's ask God to work in our hearts as we prepare to receive God's word this morning. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we ask you that you soften our hearts as we hear the message from your word this morning. We pray that you clear any distractions or lingering thoughts that we may have, so that you can speak to us directly through the scriptures. And we ask that you give us ears that are willing to hear what you are saying to us this morning. Guide us through your word to draw closer to you. Amen. 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 7 to 18. Now if the ministry that brought death, which was engraved in letters on stone, came with glory, so that the Israelites could not look steadily at the face of Moses because of its glory, transitory though it was, will not the ministry of the Spirit be even more glorious? If the ministry that brought condemnation was glorious, how much more glorious is the ministry that brings righteousness? For what was glorious has no glory now, in comparison with the surpassing glory. And if what was transitory came with glory, how much greater is the glory of that which lasts? Therefore, since we have such a hope, we are very bold. We are not like Moses, who would put a veil over his face to prevent the Israelites from seeing the end of what was passing away. But their minds were made dull. For to this day the same veil remains when the old covenant is read. It has not been removed, because only in Christ is it taken away. Even to this day when Moses read, a veil covers their hearts. But whenever anyone turns to the Lord, the veil is taken away. Now the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. And we all, who with unveiled faces contemplate the Lord's glory, are being transformed into his image with ever-increasing glory, which comes from the Lord, who is the Spirit. This is the word of the Lord.
Well, having heard God's word, we declare our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. I believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven, and was incarnate by the Holy Ghost of the Virgin Mary, and was made man, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of the Father. And he shall come again with glory to judge both the quick and the dead, whose kingdom shall have no end. And I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Lord and giver of life, who proceedeth from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spake by the prophets. And I believe in one Catholic and Apostolic Church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
It's good to be with you. My name again is Simon Manchester, and of all the messages which are coming at us at the moment, how good it is to take in God's word. So we'll pray a short prayer to begin. Gracious God, what we know not, we pray you would teach us. What we have not, we pray you would give to us. What we are not, we pray you would make us, for Jesus' sake. Amen. I read a story this week of a man who had been shipwrecked on a desert island all on his own, and as they were rescuing him, they noticed that he'd built three buildings, and they asked him what the three buildings were, and he said, well, the one over there is my house, the one next to it is the church, and the one next to it is the church that I left. We do, I think, have a sad, tragic ability, don't we, for tensions and divisions. And even Christians are perfectly capable of creating their share of divisions. The Apostle Paul felt this very deeply, and especially when a church turned against him, because if a church turned against him, it invariably turned against the truth of Christ. And this is the case that he's dealing with the Corinthian church, which we're looking at on these particular Sundays. Last week I mentioned that some troublemakers seem to have come into the Corinthian church, and they're introducing some promises that have to do more with success and immediate success, and they're criticizing the Apostle Paul, therefore, for being unimpressive and for having answers that are just too far removed. And therefore, the Apostle Paul attacks their shallow faith, their superficial ideas. And he teaches again the great gospel ministry, which is deep and long and wide and high and eternal. Now, this section of scripture we're looking at, 2 Corinthians 3 to 5, is extremely important and vital. You'll notice that our Western world thinks that Christianity is pretty unnecessary at the moment, and some even think it's unkind. But you'll notice that it also, in displacing Christianity, has put nothing in its place. It has no deep answers. The protests in the recent weeks have just created more tension, less cooperation. It strikes me that the sorry day, which is now 12 years back in 2008, has not really been heard or healed the wounds. People in our culture are trying to give themselves a lift in the best way they can, by some activity or some humour or some substance, and then of course they just droop down again. And this is to say nothing of the great pit of death which is facing people and looms over almost everything we do, whether people tragically die or eventually die. A friend of mine died this week just talking on the phone, suddenly called away. And it's into this situation that 2 Corinthians 3 to 5 is absolutely vital. Now the text today is chapter 3, verses 7 to 18, which you had read for you, and I want to divide it into two points, two parts, and they go like this. The gospel is more wonderful than you think, verses 7 to 11, and the gospel is more necessary than you think, verses 12 to 18. First of all, the gospel of Jesus is more wonderful than you think. If you read these five verses, 2 Corinthians chapter 3, 7 to 11, you'll see the word glory comes 10 times. We talk about glorious news every now and again, glorious news from the doctor, glorious news from the exams, glorious news if somebody finds a solution to the COVID-19 virus. And we say that the news of Christ is glorious news. It is glorious news, and it makes everything else look ordinary. It reaches up to heaven, and it reaches ahead into eternity. As some of you may remember hearing the gospel for the first time, and you may remember saying to yourself, this is the best news I've ever heard, and I'd be surprised if anything has ever taken its place. I assure you that there will also come a day where we will find ourselves, if we belong to Christ, sailing through the judgment. And at that point, we'll say to ourselves, the best news I ever heard was the news of Jesus Christ. Well, you see in chapter 3, verse 5, as we saw last week, that there is a verse that has to do with the letter, which is what the false teachers were preaching, something to do with the letter, and the Spirit, which the Apostle Paul was preaching. The troublemakers had brought something into the church which is a kind of letter or regulation or responsibility or duty, or perhaps we would say religion. If they were reviving interest in the Ten Commandments, it wasn't so that you'd keep the commandments to be saved, but they were putting an emphasis on the letter as if it was all there really is. In other words, the faith, the religion of the intruders is just an outward thing. This troublemaker, you see, who comes into the church in Corinth or might come into your church, is not the sort of person who brings an extra in order to be saved. You know, you must be dot, 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 you must do dot, dot, dot in order to be saved. That's not what Paul is dealing with. Paul's dealing with somebody who's reduced everything to just mere externals, just formalities, just, we might say, good living. When I was a teacher at a school many, many years ago, the headmaster said to me when I told him I was going off to the ministry, he said, well, why don't you come back as a chaplain? But just don't go on, he said, with any of that born-again rubbish. In other words, don't tell us about a new life. Just give us some morals. And Paul, you see, in the battle with these intruders, is not fighting what we call works. He's fighting what we might call nominalism or surface, shallow religion. And so he contrasts the outward message of Mount Sinai with the inward message of Christ. And I want to ask you, as you've heard these verses read, which do you think was the most glorious, the day of Mount Sinai or the day the Apostle Paul walked into Corinth? Which was the most glorious message? If I could put it like this, if you could get into a time machine and go back to Mount Sinai and see and hear, and then get back in the time machine and go forward to the arrival of Paul in Corinth and see him come and preach the gospel, which was the most glorious? Now, of course, if you're looking for fireworks, the answer is Sinai. Lightning, thunder, the voice of God, the people calling out, stop, stop. But what do we see when we see the Apostle Paul walk into Corinth? We see a little man start to speak and speak about Jesus. And the Apostle Paul says, with no apology whatsoever, my visit to Corinth was more glorious than the day of Mount Sinai. Sinai was glorious. Yes, it was. But my visit to you was more glorious. Now, why does the Apostle Paul dare to say this? Well, the answer is in verses 7 to 11. And it's because the old covenant, that is the outward covenant, chapter 3, verse 7, brought death. It only brought conviction. It didn't bring rescue. Chapter 3, verse 9, it brought condemnation. Chapter 3, verse 11, it was temporary. It was not the final word. But the new covenant, the inward covenant, chapter 3, verse 8, brings the Spirit, the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of Christ. As soon as you put your faith in Jesus, suddenly God is your Father, Jesus is your Savior, the Holy Spirit is your indweller, exactly at the same time. And then chapter 3, verse 9, he says the new covenant brings righteousness, at peace with God, right with God, in God's good books. And then chapter 3, verse 11, he says, this is forever, it's eternal. So Paul is not criticizing the old covenant. Let me make that clear. God was not doing something unkind with the old covenant. No, it was the love of God to prepare his people with the old covenant for the coming of the Savior. Just as an X-ray would get you perhaps ready to see a doctor, so the old covenant had its role in preparing people for Jesus. And I think it's fair to say that the world that we live in can only deal with externals. The religious world, that is the non-Christian religious world, is really dealing with externals. There is no coming of the Holy Spirit. There is no peace with God. There is no eternal assurance. The religions of the world deal with externals, and the wisdom of the secular world deals with externals as well. Things that will ultimately just kill, condemn, and fail you. It's only Jesus who will bring to you the Holy Spirit, new life, make you right with God, ready for eternity. And the Apostle Paul is very clever in these verses, because now the Corinthians have to choose. Is Paul talking the truth or is he talking rubbish? They have to ask themselves this question: do we want outward stuff, which did fail to bring life and hope? Or is it perfectly true that when the Apostle Paul walked into our city and preached in our city, and we listened and believed, that new life came to us and we received the Spirit of God, right with God, hope forever? So Paul, you see, is forcing them to make a decision and realize that he is speaking the truth. Now, friends, I want to just say to you again, just know for sure that the world, which is blind, cannot really get this. The world only thinks in surface. And if you do ministry, whether you're a Sunday school teacher or a youth leader, or you're running a Bible study or looking after your family or whatever you're doing, you need to know that it's the message of Jesus that brings life, right with God, and hope. Many years ago, the Sydney Morning Herald had a writer for religious affairs, and she was really very anti-Christian. She didn't seem to understand Christianity. She never represented Christianity properly. And I wrote a letter into the Herald. It was a bit of a sarcastic letter, I must confess. And it basically said, look, why have you chosen somebody who doesn't understand Christianity, who keeps attacking Christianity, when you wouldn't choose somebody who's blind to do your art reporting, and you wouldn't choose somebody who's deaf to do your music reporting? Well, within 24 hours, she rang me at my desk. She said, what's your problem? You know, what don't you like about what I'm writing? And I said, if you don't mind me saying, you don't have the faculties to really understand. You need to come to Christ to understand Christ. And if you'd like to have lunch, I'd be very happy to explain. Well, of course, she had no real interest. And we have to keep going with the ministry of Christ, because this is the ministry which is going to bring people a brand new life and get them ready for eternity. And if you've put your faith in Jesus Christ, I want to assure you that you must this week lift up your head and say, I'm so thankful that in all the changes and all the difficulties, a brand new life has come to me. I am now at peace with God. He sees me as his friend and child, and I'm ready for the future. So that's the first thing. The gospel is more wonderful than you think, and than I think. Secondly, the gospel is more necessary than you think. Verses 12 to 18. Now, Paul says, as soon as you understand this, as soon as you see that the message of Jesus is what's going to change the heart and get people with God and for eternity, you become very bold. He says this in chapter 3, verse 12. We become very bold. We can't go to sleep at this point. Paul says, borrowing a moment in history, when Moses came down from Mount Sinai and his face was shining with the glory of God, and he veiled his face to stop the Israelites from being afraid at the brightness, the Apostle Paul says he was not only veiling his face to save the Israelites from the brightness, but he was saving them from seeing the fading. Chapter 3, verse 13. He veiled his face, says Paul, so that they would not see what was a fading glory, an outward fading glory. So it was a double sadness when Paul speaks of Moses coming down from Mount Sinai, because Moses is veiling his face to prevent the Israelites from seeing something that's fearful but is passing. And Paul borrows this, and he says in chapter 3, verse 14, do you understand that there is a veil, there's a cloth veil, which Moses put over his face, but everybody who listens to law, listens to old covenant, listens to religion, listens to letter, has a spiritual veil, a kind of a blindness, and it's absolutely true. Earlier this year, I was at the Wailing Wall in Jerusalem, and I asked some of the Jewish young men what the grief was at the wall. What is the wailing at the wall for? And you know, they were completely divided. They really had no idea between them what the wailing was for. The best they could come up with was that there was some wailing for the suffering of the past and the hope that there might be a better future. That's all they could really say. And I wonder whether you think a person today who's listening to the world give instructions or regulations or education or motivation or moralism, do you think any of that is going to bring life eternal? It won't. It's a veil. It doesn't open eyes or open hearts at all. But, says Paul in chapter 3, verse 14, in Christ the veil goes and the life comes. Again, in chapter 3, verse 16, he says, when someone turns to the Lord, no veil, freedom. There's a great 3:16 for you. We often talk about John 3:16, God so loved the world. Here's a 2 Corinthians 3:16, turn to the Lord. That's the gospel. Turn to the Lord. And there will be the lifting of the veil and the freedom and the giving of the Holy Spirit. So the apostle goes on to say the experience for the Christian is not that we have a fading glory, like Moses coming down from Mount Sinai, but because we've come to Christ, there is a brightening glory. It is as if the believer with a new life is being renewed, is renewed every day, and on till the likeness of Christ. I hope, friends, as you consider this wonderful gospel, you will say to yourself again and again through the week, look, for all the problems that I have and all the silly thoughts that come to my head and all the challenges in front of me, in my heart, the new life through Christ. As I lift up to God in heaven, he has taken the barrier away and sees me as a beloved child. And as I look forward, that death is just a door through to glory. In, up, on. The gospel is absolutely wonderful and necessary. I wonder whether this message has become a little stale for you. And I wonder why it's become stale for you. As I reflect on my own heart and life, I think that it's often because it's the divided heart which makes me stale. I lose the joy of fellowship with Christ because of this compromising life. Or is it that there has been lots of shallow attention to the Word of God, but lots of concentrated attention to television and things that are not that important? If you're in a desert time in your spiritual life, it can be a very wonderful time because it can make you more thirsty for Christ, to seek him more carefully, more faithfully, more joyfully, and to cause your faith to get keener. Well, this is really the message of 1 Corinthians 3 this morning, and I hope you'll remember these two things. Number one, the gospel is more wonderful than we think it is. Number two, the gospel is more necessary than we think it is. In my paper this week, I read of somebody called Steve Bing, who had apparently $600 million to his name. He had his own jet, he had all the prettiest girls in the world. And yet it's only a couple of weeks ago that he took himself to the veranda of his 27th floor of the hotel that he was living in and jumped to his death. Everything the world could possibly offer, all the surface things, but nothing inside, no peace with God, no future. It seems that he was desperate. And this gospel message, which we have been privileged to hear, is more wonderful and more necessary than anything we can possibly offer to the world. Let's bow our heads and pray. We thank you, our gracious God, for bringing to our ears this wonderful message of Christ, to turn to Christ. We thank you for the gift of your Spirit, new life, the gift of righteousness, of being right with you, and of eternity, a future, a hope, forever. We ask that you would help us to appreciate this And we ask that you would help us to communicate this in the way we live and speak. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Let us pray for the whole state of Christ's Church militant here in earth. Almighty and ever-living God, who by thy holy apostle has taught us to make prayers and supplications and to give thanks for all men, we humbly beseech thee most mercifully to accept our alms and oblations and to receive these our prayers, which we offer unto thy divine majesty, beseeching thee to inspire continually the universal church with the spirit of truth, unity, and concord. And grant that all they that do confess thy holy name may agree in the truth of thy holy word and live in unity and godly love. We beseech thee also to save and defend all Christian kings, princes, and governors, and especially thy servant Elizabeth, our queen, that under her we may be godly and quietly governed. And grant unto her whole council and to all that are put in authority under her, that they may truly and indifferently minister justice to the punishment of wickedness and vice and to the maintenance of thy true religion and virtue. Give grace, O Heavenly Father, to all bishops and curates, that they may both by their life and doctrine set forth thy true and lively word, and rightly and duly administer thy holy sacraments. And to all thy people give thy heavenly grace, and especially to this congregation here, online, that with meek heart and due reverence, they may hear and receive thy holy word, truly serving thee in holiness and righteousness all the days of their life. And we most humbly beseech thee of thy goodness, O Lord, to comfort and succour all them who in this transitory life are in trouble, sorrow, need, sickness, or any other adversity. And we also bless thy holy name for all thy servants departed this life in thy faith and fear, beseeching thee to give us grace so to follow their good examples, that with them we may be partakers of thy heavenly kingdom. Grant this, O Father, for Jesus Christ's sake, our only mediator and advocate. Amen.
The invitation to the Lord's Supper. Ye that do truly and earnestly repent you of your sins and are in love and charity with your neighbours and intend to lead a new life, following the commandments of God and walking from henceforth in his holy ways, draw near with faith and take this holy sacrament to your comfort and make your humble confession to Almighty God, meekly kneeling upon your knees. Let's pray together. Almighty God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, maker of all things and judge of all men, we acknowledge and bewail our manifold sins and wickedness, which we from time to time most grievously have committed by thought, word and deed. Against thy divine majesty, provoking most justly thy wrath and indignation against us, we do earnestly repent and are heartily sorry for these our misdoings. The remembrance of them is grievous unto us. The burden of them is intolerable. Have mercy upon us. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father. For thy Son, our Lord Jesus Christ's sake, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may ever hereafter serve and please thee in newness of life, to the honour and glory of thy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who of his great mercy has promised forgiveness of sins to all them that with hearty repentance and true faith turn unto him, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and bring you to everlasting life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And hear what comfortable words our Saviour Christ saith unto all that truly turn to him.
Come unto me, all that travail and are heavy laden, and I will refresh you. Hear what St. John saith. If anyone sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous, and he is the propitiation for our sins. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks unto our Lord God. It is meet and right so to do. It is very meet, right, and our bounden duty that we should at all times and in all places give thanks unto thee, O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty, Everlasting God, and therefore with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify thy glorious name evermore, praising thee and saying, Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of thy glory. Glory be to thee, O Lord Most High. Amen. The prayer of humble access. We do not presume to come to this thy table, O merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in thy manifold and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under thy table. But thou art the same Lord, whose property is always to have mercy. Grant us, therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of thy dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that our sinful bodies may be made clean by his body, and our souls washed through his most precious blood, and that we may evermore dwell in him and he in us. Amen. Almighty God, our heavenly Father, who of thy tender mercy didst give thine only Son, Jesus Christ, to suffer death upon the cross for our redemption, who made there by his one oblation of himself once offered a full, perfect and sufficient sacrifice, oblation and satisfaction for the sins of the whole world, and did institute and in his holy gospel command us to continue a perpetual memory of that his precious death until his coming again. Hear us, O merciful Father, we most humbly beseech thee, and grant that we, receiving these thy creatures of bread and wine, according to thy Son, our Saviour Jesus Christ's holy institution, in remembrance of his death and passion, may be partakers of his blessed body and blood, who in the same night that he was betrayed took the bread, and when he'd given thanks, he brake it, and he gave it to his disciples, saying, Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Likewise, after supper, he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, Drink ye all of this, for this is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for you and for many for the remission of sins. Do this as oft as ye shall drink it, in remembrance of me. Amen. Well, we welcome all who love and serve Jesus to receive the communion, the body and the blood of Christ, spiritually by faith. Of course, we're online, and so I can't give you the elements in person, but the rubrics in the Book of Common Prayer, Communion for the Sick, tell us that we don't need to take the elements to be able to feed on Christ in our hearts by faith. And that's what we're going to do now. So I encourage you at home, take and eat this in remembrance that Christ died for you. Feed on him in your heart by faith with thanksgiving. And drink this in remembrance that Christ's blood was shed for you, and be thankful. Amen. Let's pray the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive them that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Almighty and ever-living God, we most heartily thank thee for that thou dost vouchsafe to feed us who have duly received these holy mysteries with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of thy Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ, and dost assure us thereby of thy favour and goodness towards us, and that we are very members incorporate in the mystical body of thy Son, which is the blessed company of all faithful people, and are also heirs through hope of thy everlasting kingdom, by the merits of the most precious death and passion of thy dear Son. And we most humbly beseech thee, O Heavenly Father, so to assist us with thy grace, that we may continue in that holy fellowship, and that we might continue in that holy fellowship and do all such good works as thou hast prepared for us to walk in, through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with thee and the Holy Ghost be all honour and glory, world without end. Amen. The peace of God, which passeth all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost be amongst you and remain with you always. Amen.
Hey friends, it's Sam Crisp here with CMS in Taiwan, and I'm actually standing on our balcony at the moment. I thought I'd give you a quick look at our neighbourhood. We live on the outskirts of the city, and so there's a bit of abandoned, not yet used ground here, and off in the distance you can see some of the local mountains, which is lovely. I also wanted to show you this pot plant of ours. We like trying to grow things on our balcony. And this particular plant here is one of the most common local vegetables in Taiwan. It's actually sweet potato leaves. You can cut them off and stir fry them with garlic, and it's very tasty. This plant was grown by Shan Chan from scratch. And in our latest newsletter, you can read a reflection from her about what the process of growing this plant has taught her about our journey as missionaries and gospel fellowship. So do check that out. This month, we are continuing to learn, studying culture and language. We've recently done a cultural learning project looking at fortune telling in Taiwan, which is very interesting. We might share more about that another time. I'm continuing to study Chinese and sharing and learning Bible stories each week with my non-Christian Chinese teacher, which is really exciting. This month is also the last month for the CMS Lasting Hope Appeal. Hopefully you've heard about that already. This year, CMS needs to raise around $1.6 million to continue supporting all of their existing missionaries and to be sending new ones out. We're really thankful for all of you who give already regularly to support us and our family here in Taiwan. At the moment, we're at about 75% of our total support level. And so the way that CMS fills the gap for us in our support level and all of their other missionaries is through the Lasting Hope Appeal. Now, we know that at the moment, for many of you, in light of coronavirus, finances are a bit more uncertain. But if you are able, please consider whether you might be able to make a one-off donation to the CMS Lasting Hope Appeal to support us and support CMS as they send out more missionaries, all with the goal of seeing a world that knows Jesus. Thanks again for all of your support and prayers, and I'll see you next time.
Thank you again for joining us for online church. I'm really looking forward to joining with many of you in person next Sunday at 9 a.m. at St. Peter's, at 10 a.m. at St. Martin's, and 6 p.m. at St. Peter's, as well as, of course, our Wednesday communion service at St. Martin's, Kalara. It is very exciting prospects to be able to gather again together. Our online church will be continuing for those who are not yet able to join us yet. And so we're praying that all the technology goes well for all of that. Please do pray for Simon Manchester as he continues to bring us God's word from 2 Corinthians chapters 3 to 5. What a blessing it is to have him bring God's word to us. And please do take the time to think through what God is saying to you in his word today and during the week. And I know many of the growth groups are looking at the Bible study questions that Simon Manchester has prepared for us as well. And I pray that that's a great blessing to you and your groups this week. I hope you're able to catch up over Zoom after the service today to encourage one another in the Lord Jesus Christ. And thank you also, just as we conclude, for all those who are able to give and support the work of Anglicare by bringing food and other goods yesterday to our churches at St. Martin's and at St. Peter's. What a blessing to receive these, and we will they'll be collected this week, and they'll go to Anglicare and help support those who are in deep need at this time. Thank you very much for your generosity. Well, as we conclude, let me pray. Gracious God, you made an eternal covenant with us through the blood of your Son and brought him back from the dead as the great shepherd of your sheep. Equip us with everything good for doing your will. Work in us what is pleasing to you, through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. Hebrews 12 says, since we are receiving a kingdom that cannot be shaken, let us be thankful and so serve God in a way that is pleasing to him with reverence and awe, for our God is a consuming fire. Amen.